Aurora is the title of the Nigeria Art Society UK annual art exhibition at the WAC Gallery, Waterloo, London. Aurora spectrums of colour symbolise the multicultural identities in Britain today. And epitomise the vibrant palettes, avant-garde techniques and sheer verve of the works produced by artists of the Nigeria Art Society UK. The show is featuring the works of the following 17 prominent Nigerian artists working in the diaspora.
Standing next to Tony Ndikanwu, standing here with Ade Oguntimu, Tunde Akin Niraye. With me, I've got Ray Soko, Lara Imoisi Imo Nige, Emmanuel Okoro, Titus Agbara from Delta State, Kunle Ade Gorioye, Kola Badibo, Dotun Adegwite, Michael Echekoba, Chike Azonye, who's the Vice President of the Nigerian Art Society, the President of the Nigerian Art Society himself, Hassan Aliyu.
Ladies and gentlemen, stay tuned. You will get to meet the artists themselves. And if you're thinking or looking for something to buy, this is the place to come. I understand the exhibition is on for at least over a week or so. So do please go on the internet. It's called Aurora. The address is 14 Baileys Road, London. Please come out and support the good work of our fellow Nigerians doing great things. Thank you.
We're here at the WAC Art Gallery in Waterloo, South London, and I'm standing next to Tony Ndikanwu with this beautiful, inspiring piece of work that, to be quite honest, for me, as a non-artist, I haven't got a clue what was going on through his mind, so I'm just going to ask him to let us into a bit of what was going on in his mind when he created this awesome piece of work. What inspired you to create this, Tony?
Yeah, I've been working on a series of paintings or artworks related about God's relationship to man, and I've been thinking about it a lot. You know, we do say God created man in his own image, and I've been trying to ask a lot of people what they understand by God and who God is, and the description I kept getting sounded like another man who was probably a bigger version of us. So, and I started toying with the idea that it's possible that man has just come up with the idea of God as a way of avoiding responsibility for their actions or for things that are happening to them. So that's why we have the title Man Made God or God Made Man. So it's just that dichotomy I'm trying to deal with. Okay. It stems from the fact that we say God is all the creator of humanity and everything that we have in it. Okay? And since God has created man, then we've lived and we've grown. And we've now become equally creative. And it said we were created in his own image. That means we had the same energy that God does have. So we are as creative as God is because we got that creativity from him. So I'm looking at the early man that lived that could not communicate and somehow found a way of creating language, not only creating grunts and language and things that became language sounds. They started writing it down and it makes sense to everybody, and we've built houses, we've tried to transcend nature, lived once we lived in snow, built the igloos and later built houses with warmers, with heaters, houses with air conditioning, and things always solving a problem. So that's God attribute, creativity. In the painting in itself, I was trying to put in some of the things that we've done to transcend nature, but symbols of them. And I use a lot of symbolism coming from the Nsukka school of art. We call it Uli art, the traditional art forms that we find in Uli, part of Igbo land. And there we use symbols to communicate certain things. That was before the Western civilization came and probably called our practices pagan practices, things we had as designs or patterns in our shrines, so to speak.
Okay, so would you say this is your own interpretation of creation? In, you know, because as you've been talking, all I've heard is mostly the word creation, creation. How long did it take for you to actually create this piece of work?
Yeah, it takes a lot. It's got a lot of processes in it. It's first raw clay, cut them up into slabs, fire them, glaze them, color them, redesign on top of them and reglaze it again, then weave them all together before you get what you get. It takes a lot of process. It's long. It's not like you say, if I were to calculate the amount of time, it would probably take a period of about 6 months.
Okay, thank you very much, Tony. Thank you for sharing your lovely piece of work with us this evening. And all I can say is congratulations on a fantastic job you've done here. And, you know, you never know. This could be hanging up in someone's home in the near future. Any plans to sell that this evening?
Yeah, if someone wants to buy it, it's available for sale.
I'm standing here with Ade Oguntimu. He told me how to say his name. You know, I walked in this evening and I saw this beautiful piece of work and I felt like a child just staring at it, you know, all the beautiful vibrant colors, and I'm thinking to myself, what exactly was this man thinking of when he decided to create this lovely piece of work? So I'm gonna let you sort of like take us on a journey. Just tell us exactly what it was that was going through your mind as you created this piece of work, Ade.
Okay, my name is Ade Oguntimu, like you said. The inspiration of this painting is actually in response to Lee Krasner and Jackson Pollock, old American painters who used to paint without brushes or drawings or anything, you know, it was just pure paint. I went to an exhibition in the West End of London and got inspired by them. That, okay, this is like a benchmark and I could take it a notch higher. Hence, when I got to my studio, I decided to mix up a few paints here, there and everywhere with a few mediums and started splashing away different colors and all in from a landscape in Kano. And added in a few bits and pieces representing people. Because I'm an expressionist.
Can I just say, just seeing you express yourself so much, I can see that you have like a very childlike sort of like, you know, personality, because the way you talked about, you know, you just went straight for the canvas, you know, splashing the paint and all that, and then you actually kept it. So you didn't actually have to sort of like sit down to think, what do I want to paint? You just sort of like went straight to the canvas and you're just splashing away and created this. Is that what you're trying to tell us?
Yes. Is it not? Normally, my brain doesn't stop working. I'm always thinking. Even coming here tonight, I have developed a few paintings in my head. So once I get to the studio, I don't have to think or plan. All I'm doing is just looking at a blank canvas and I can see exactly where I'm going and I just go for it. A splash away or draw away.
Fabulous. Thank you so much, Ade. How long did it actually take for you to create this piece of work?
From the first drop to my hanging it up, 2.5 weeks of constant work every day.
Fabulous. 2.5 weeks, you know, because like you hear some painters say, you know, their work takes like a year and stuff like that. But obviously because you were having so much fun, you couldn't stop.
You got it. That's exactly what happened.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. Thank you. Enjoy the rest of the evening.
All right, you too. Don't work too hard.
I'll try not to. And I'm standing right here with Tunde Akinnuoye and this beautiful, delicate piece of work. I came in here this evening and I was looking at this work and at first I couldn't sort of like notice what was happening there, and the closer I looked, I actually saw that there was a story being told on this lovely ceramic piece of work. So I'm just going to leave you to actually just share what actually inspired you to get into this sort of art.
I've been doing ceramics for a couple of years, probably about 25 years. I consider myself as a kind of a contemporary ceramic artist, so I do draw and paint. And with this particular piece, I was trying to kind of bring two-dimensional into a kind of a 3D work. So I started get influenced by like the Jackson Pollocks and kind of splashing all the underglaze on a white piece of thrown thrown away. So, and after doing that, let it dry and start scratching images on it. So it, the images are not planned. So the images comes as when the strokes of the splash goes into it. So they try and, you know, that's the whole idea behind it.
Okay, so this is just like you splashing paint on this work, but then you actually do go and do something else. Because, I mean, for me, looking at this, it just doesn't look like paint being splashed around, because I can actually see some intricate sort of like, you know, drawings and stuff like that.
Yeah, as I said, it's like Jackson Pollock's kind of style. But it's kind of, you have to follow the different brushes. You use different brushes to kind of create it. But it's something that you really have to be taught, is well thought of, and it's not just a fluke thing. And once you throw the pot, because ceramics is quite different, you have to make sure you make the pots to the right requirements, they dry properly, and they are put slips on it, white David Leitch slips, porcelain slip. And after that, I put underglaze, black underglaze. And the black underglaze, it's dry, then it's like a sgraffito, kind of scratching the images out of it. But that's when it took a long time. You really need to look at the images, and I just follow where it comes in. I'm being led by the pots, if you put it that way.
Okay. Fantastic. Thank you very much, and I hope someone snaps up this lovely piece of work this evening. Thank you very much. With me, I've got Ray Soko and this beautiful piece of work that I have been talking to him about all evening, titled Urban Squeeze. Ray, please tell us, what exactly was going on in your mind, in your head, when you thought you'd create this? I mean, you've told me the story already, but I want you to actually tell the viewers what was happening and what actually inspired you to create this fantastic piece of work.
Thanks. Basically, this work is, it just represents the visual divide between the haves and the have-nots. And everywhere you go, it could be in a city, it could be in a town, it could be in a country. And what it all depicts is that usually you find that the lower class people are squeezed. You understand? Wherever you find them, you understand, they're being squeezed. Their livelihood is being squeezed. Everything about them is being squeezed at the expense of trying to satisfy, like, the upper class. If you have a look at it, if I'll show you something here. If you look at this part of the work, you understand, this, it's dark, right? But there's so much going on in it. There's a lot of tension in it, you understand? It's ragged, you understand? There's this feeling about, like survival. And if you take a closer look again, this part of the work represents nature, which is the sea. And this part represents the encroachment, you understand? Right now what happens is, a good point in time was Morocco in Lagos. They went there, got rid of the shanty towns. They didn't tell people where they had to go. They just said, get out, you understand? What did they replace it with? They replaced it with luxurious houses for the big shots in town. And it is a social problem, a big time social problem. Because where do you expect people to go? And also, we have all across the world, you get places where people, like businesses, they call it gentrification in certain areas. But then again, if you look at this part of it, with these white, warm-like designs on it, what that represents is people are actually creeping. They're actually creeping into the depressed areas, taking over their land. They could start with, just buying old, run-down patches of land, breaking them down, leveling them up, and building new structures there, you understand, for the affluent people. And it's sad. I think it's sad.
Okay, thank you very much, Ray. I can see a lot of passion sort of like just coming out of you as you actually talk about this painting. I can see that you are a true patriotic son of Nigeria, and I can see that you want good to come out of your country. And I just hope that, you know, anyone watching this, you know, can actually sort of like see, and I pray that someone actually, you know, gets a hold of this painting that makes a statement and sort of like have it hang up somewhere, maybe in the government houses in Nigeria. And when they look at it, they can actually say, you know, we need to do right by the people. So, Lara, I've stared at this painting most of the evening because it brings back memories from a couple of years ago. Looking at this painting, I can see three beautiful women, lovely, vibrant colors. But behind all of this, there's a sad story. I would let you, the artist, tell myself and the viewers your story. I'd allow you interpret your piece of work.
The title of the work is Memoirs of the Chibok Girl. Not actually the Chibok Girls, but Memoirs of Chibok. I've used the vibrant colors to represent an expected successful end to find these girls to be freed, for the girls to be freed. They were actually kidnapped in April 2014, and it's been some years now. And I'm happy that it has brought about a lot of awareness of this terrible act, this barbaric act of the terrorists. So I think people all over the world, they have denounced this act. And I want to see this on the brighter side. That's why I've used the vibrant colors. And coincidentally, I heard news this morning that 21 of them were released this morning. But I don't know how far, but it was on the news anyway, by the Swiss government and the Red Cross. So I still hope for good news, you know, for these children, and a lot of faith. We should have a lot of it, and it has brought about also humanity, and also I hope the girls will be brought back to love, life, and protection, which they actually deserve.
I love the fact that you've actually said you decided to use bright colors to paint a picture of hope, because it's so easy for people to sort of like remain in a state of, you know, despondency, like no hope. But what you have done here, you've actually said that there is still hope for them, so we should not give up hope.
Like this painting was done before today, and we just had news that 21 of them were released. So it's like hoping for a brighter tomorrow, and hopefully the rest of them will be released.
Well, I say a hope is a better place to be than to actually be in a place where you think you just lose all hope and think nothing good can come out. So thank you very much for actually inspiring, you know, me to continue to hope for the best. And like you said, 21 girls have been freed today. You know, who knows what news we'll hear tomorrow. Thank you, Lara. Thank you. And here I have Imoisi Imonige. He told me how to say his name properly. From?
I'm from Edo State. Esako speaking Edo State.
Esako speaking Edo State, he says. I saw your painting this evening, and I actually thought these three men were about to jump out at me. That's how much this painting, this piece of work, looks like it's alive to me. But I'm sure there is a story behind this painting, and I want to hear from the artist's own mouth.
Yeah, this work, the title is Ogbiba. Ogbiba is just like, is the name of the drum that control the dance. It's actually a masquerade dance, but it's an ancestral dance, and people, like, we grown up to see it, it looks like it's a spiritual thing. You know, when you wear a masquerade, you cease to be that person you used to be. You become another person entirely. That is like a spirit possess you. So if you look at the work, I'm just trying to portray that vibrantness in our traditional settings, the traditional ancestral music that was laid down from our past ancestors. So that's what I was trying to do. If you look at it, like as I said, it's a masquerade dance, but I never portray those masquerade. I only take one aspect of it, which is the drummers that control the masquerade with their drum. And if you look at the paintings, You see, most of them, their heads are cut off to show that affinity, that they is affinity to that they are affinity and they go to that spiritual realm to connect with the ancestral spirits, to show that the duality of nature.
Okay. Thank you very much, Imoisi. I must say I'm really proud to be an African tonight, just seeing all the lovely handiwork of my brothers and sisters right here in London. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. So I'm here with Emmanuel Okoro and this beautiful piece of bronze work. I mean, I've been looking at work on canvas, paintings, oil and stuff like that, and this is something completely different. And I'm just looking at this intricate piece of work and thinking to myself, how did this man standing before me create this beautiful object I see? So I'm going to let him take us through the journey of how he came about creating this. Emmanuel.
Wow. This sculpture is called The Sleeping Buddha. The Sleeping Buddha for me started in 1999 when I first had my first studio. Having the first studio gave me an opportunity to let loose of who I am as an artist itself, what has been buried long since my childhood. And so the opportunity in which I did get in Hackney Wick, in my first studio, I created series of works, and then The Sleeping Buddha came out. But prior to The Sleeping Buddha coming out, I was doing a lot of meditation in order to understand myself, understand what journey I'm traveling in, where I'm going, or literally who I am, or should I say, a man becoming a man. So Buddha came out.
I wanted to ask you why the name Sleeping Buddha. I mean, I've heard of Sleeping Beauty, but how did the name come about, Sleeping Buddha?
Sleeping Buddha is more to do, like I was saying, from the meditational aspect. I needed to find out where I was going. I needed to find myself to understand who I am. And I've seen, walked around England, London itself, looking at various exhibitions, online, pictures, Buddha itself. So in order, I questioned myself, in order for Buddha to be where Buddha is, Buddha had to have journeyed the long journey to understand himself. I have the right to call this Sleeping Buddha. But when I did reach the stage in which I got to in 2003, where I did understand the madness within the art itself, then the name came. I didn't have a name for it, but then the name came.
So would you say you've kind of like found peace within yourself? Because from everything I've heard, you know, you went on a journey trying to discover who you were as a person. And would you say having created this piece of work has made you find that inner peace?
Not inner peace, but that's what I was looking for as a young man. I was looking for such a thing, but growing up where I was growing up, inner peace was very hard to, in the concrete jungle, inner peace is very hard to find. So the only thing I could do was find any little bit of me in which I could salvage within that period of time. But I did know that time, there are more things to be done in time. Festac is my heritage. I remembered it. 1977. It's always been on my mind, but I never really knew why growing up. But when I was creating this, and the crown itself is Festac, but the peacefulness itself is both Festac and the Buddha itself.
Thank you very much, Emmanuel. I mean, you've just taken me back to 1977, Festac 77. A lot of us as children remember Nigerian Festac. And thank you for taking me back on the journey. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Paitos Agbara from Delta State. Looking at this beautiful piece of work here, doesn't look anything like Delta State, but I'm sure you've got a story behind this painting to share.
Yeah, there's a lot of stories behind the painting. This was done for the Sky Art Landscape Artist of the Year 2016. So I did it for 4 hours competition all over the UK. Artists all over the UK come together for this competition. So I did this piece, and it take me over to the semi-final. Yeah, it's really an ancient site or building, but when I was making the painting, I have a reflection back home, because there are some old and ancient building in a very tranquil environment, if I would say calm, serene. That's my kind of nature. That's the kind of place I love going to make my painting when I was back home. So coming to the UK for the Sky Art Landscape Artist of the Year competition, when I saw this scene, I said, oh, this is a perfect reflection of my life back home anyway.
If you don't mind my asking, how long have you been painting?
Oh, I've been painting ever since I was a kid, yeah. I think when I was in primary school, that's when my love for painting started. And whenever I make a painting in my coursework, there are some of my classmates that couldn't draw, and they went behind me to trace my painting on their own book and have to draw from it. So whenever they do that, they got my own painting, my own work being not that good again as I like it, as I want it to be. So it pissed me off. Sometimes I'll just be crying for seeing my work.
Just looking at you, I can just sort of like see the joy in your eyes. You know, when I asked you how long have you been painting, I just saw your face kind of light up. You know, I've been painting since I was a little boy. You know, I can just sort of like sense the passion sort of like oozing out of you. I'm sure you're really proud of your works. And you, like you said, you've entered this for a competition. So when would the results be coming out? This year?
The results will be coming out. The series is now on the telly, on Sky Art Channel. Yeah, you can tune on to it every Tuesday, 8 p.m. for the Sky Landscape Artist of the Year 2016. Yeah, then you could see this piece and you could watch me, all the process it takes to achieve it. Yeah.
Fabulous. I'll be rooting for you. Thank you very much. Thank you. So I'm standing right here with Kunle Adegboriyoye. He's told me how to pronounce the name correctly. I'm a Nigerian girl, but I struggle sometimes. But I came in here this evening. I've seen two of your artworks, boy or girl? Boy, and there's one upstairs of a girl as well. But I'm sure that there is a lot behind what I see, more than just the pretty cute faces of the boy and girl. So I'm sure you will tell me and you'll tell the viewers what inspired you to create this piece of work.
Okay. This painting was inspired by the trouble in the south of Nigeria, the Niger Delta area. That is where Nigeria gets most of the oil, which is our main income in Nigeria. And when you look at the area very well, you discover that the place has not been developed to the standard that is expected. And you have a lot of troubles there, and you have a lot of different groups agitating and fighting and trying to reclaim the whole environment. But the inspiration behind this one is I am not too particularly interested about the agitators and the fighters using guns, which they can defend themselves. But I'm particularly interested in the little kids, the children of that area, defenseless children that, not to their own doing, they were born in that situation and they were there. And it's very, very unfortunate for them. And that's what really moved me to paint something like this, that if you look at the face of the boy, it's very emotional and a lot is happening in the painting. If you look very deeply, you see a lot of white faces, happy white faces. We have Shell, we have Mobil, we have Chevron, we have so many oil companies making billions of dollars from this end, from this area. And you have someone who was born there, who the land belongs to, suffering without nothing. And that's what really moved me. And that's why when you look at the painting like that, you should look up there. I've deliberately put something there that says oil fights, and it's upside down so that you have to look very well to see exactly what is going on there. And then you have a lot of protesters protesting against the whole scenario in that area. Then also, my wording is there, protect our heritage. In a way, to me, that oil belongs to us. It's the heritage of these people, and it needs to be protected. And that is exactly what informed me to actually paint this.
I must say, just listening to you talk and just seeing the passion coming out of you, when I came in here this evening, I'm not an artist myself. I looked at this painting and all I could see was the picture of a cute boy. And just listening to you talk now has made me actually look deeper at the painting rather than looking at the finer aspect of it, but looking within the eyes of the young boy, like you said, you know, living in a community that is supposed to be rich, but is poor. It's really amazing that we have such wonderful talents, you know, in our country, Nigeria. But you're here today in Waterloo, London, exhibiting your work. Thank you very much. Thank you. So I'm here with Kola Badibo and staring at this beautiful, brightly colored piece of work. I like colors. I'm sure you got a story to tell me about this beautiful painting. Yes?
Yes, I do. It's a piece called Migration. And I didn't want to title it. I actually didn't plan to give it a title. I was debating whether to give it a title. It's essentially a simple piece about, if you look at it, it seems rather obvious. It's about people moving to, whole tribes of people, groups of people moving in a direction. And it's interesting when I speak to people, people have said to me they're moving towards hope, they're moving towards the light and all that. And it's partly true. But the other side of it, why I've left it very vague, is that when you look at it, the question is actually, are they moving towards it or are they moving away from it? There's the issue about race, which is something that comes up all the time, about how society looks at what's happening, about, you know, the boat people, the whole migration from Africa, people moving to the West and all that. And it's looking at that, saying, actually, depending on where you put it, you can't tell whether they're black, white, you know, what tribe they are. But when you look at it then, the question is, are they moving towards that or away? If it's hope, they're moving towards hope. If it's better living and all that, they're moving towards that. And you could argue that that's like the African migration that's happening. But if you change that, for example, now to somewhere like Syria or so, they're moving away. This is flames. So the same thing that looks like so much hope could be a disaster. And so they're running away from it. So this could be crowds running away from something like that. And it's been interesting to listen to people talk. People have been talking from their point of experience. So people have said that. And then only one person actually said to me, is that a cornfield? And I said, yes, it is.
I actually thought the same as well. I was actually waiting to say that to you. But when you said talking and you mentioned that, you know, because another thought that came to mind was people moving towards light as well. But then I thought people on a cornfield moving towards, I wasn't sure. And I thought I'd rather wait for you to actually tell me. But one thing I've heard from a lot of the artists this evening is like there's like a political sort of like, you know, there's all this underlying political sort of like, you know, statements going on. A lot of people just showing their passion for what's happening around the world and, you know, sadness and, you know, is yours anything to do with any particular part of the world or just the world in general? Because, I mean,
in general, but then, like I said, you see, that's why I said I bring it to something like Syria and what's happening. And then you suddenly realize that they're not black people. Because certain things are, it's so easy to sort of focus and generalize and pick on people. We have to talk about what's going on. I think one of the things about the collective is that we reflect, we feel that we have a voice, we have an opinion about something. And it's kind of our job to entertain, but in entertaining, to educate people. And you can only tell your own story. And I'm very passionate about storytelling and telling our own story and giving it. And I'm very keen to get that balance. So we've had lots of what's happened about putting a lot of African stuff down. But then I also personally, I worry about the fact that the antidote seems to be, well, let's just do this blackness and everything that's not black is bad. And I think it cannot be that. I live in a society, this is my country, this is my environment, I have children here, and I have to be relevant to it. So some of what I say, even though a lot of my work is African, but the idea, the motivation behind it has to be a commentary that's relevant to anybody living where I am, regardless of color of skin or so. But yes, we have to be, a lot of the works will appear to be political, and I think we make no apologies about that. It is, right? That's our experience.
Thank you very much for sharing with us this evening, and you know, all the very best for your future endeavors. Thank you. So I'm right here at the WAC Art Gallery in Waterloo with Chike Azonye, who's the Vice President of the Nigerian Art Society. We're standing right beside one of his beautiful artwork, and I'm sure he'll take us on a journey how this all came together.
Thank you for this. I would like to talk about my painting, which is entitled Elements of Creation. This work started... it's a kind of sequence. It's a sequel to the previous works I have. It's like a series where I'm trying to talk about some philosophical concepts. And in this one, we have the elements of creation, which takes us back to the Big Bang theory, where you have diversity in unity, or unity in diversity. And here I try to emphasize that during creation, a number of things came into play, and I have tried to represent those with different colors. That when all these things come together, then you have life. So I have represented the sun with yellow, the earth with brown, the waters with blue, and then the green, which symbolized life. So if all these elements could be made to exist in Mars, I think there'll be life in Mars. And so this is one of my main reasons to paint this, just my interpretation of the of those elements that make up creation.
Just ask one question, you know, so for someone who's not an artist herself, you know, if I hadn't heard you say anything, I probably would just be looking at this and just looking at beautiful, bold colors. When you started painting as an artist, did you have a direction, like you wanted to go? I'm just trying to sort of like get into the head of an artist, you know. Do you, I mean, because I've heard some people, you know, sort of like say they paint about like political things, and you know, did you as an artist have a direction that you wanted to go as an artist? I mean, I don't know if I'm making any sense.
Yeah, when I started as many years ago, I started by translating poetry into paintings, and I was doing more of a figurative work. But over the years, my work has progressed from figurative to stylized works, and from stylized works to now abstraction. So now my work seems to make its focus more towards the philosophical rather than something that is of everyday life. So it's more philosophical, and that is why some of the elements here, not only just colors, but they are representative of what I see to make up creation in my own way of looking at it. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, so for people like us who don't really know much about art, you have to have that sort of like artistic eye to be able to interpret your works. Is that what you're saying?
More or less. But you see, you don't have to always interpret a work of art. You can enjoy it. At times, the artist has to lead you into his or her own work, especially when it comes to abstraction. Here, as I've always said, I work more with my inner self, who directs the colors I put, the way I put the colors, until all the elements come together as a unit and balanced. Once I look at my painting and they're balanced, and my heart tells me, look, this is okay, and I know that's where it is, then I sign it. So unfortunately, it might be difficult for some people to translate or to understand my painting, but I'm always there to interpret and to assist, yes.
Thank you very much, GK. Thank you. It's really been lovely talking to you. Thank you. Traders at Dawn, Dotun Adegbite, I bet you've got a story to tell me about this magnificent piece of work. I love the colors, the rich colors. As I was saying to one of your fellow artists earlier on, for someone who's not an artist, it's okay for me to look at the pretty colors and just say, oh, I like the colors and this looks really cute. But I'm sure for you, the artist, there is a story behind this that's got deeper meanings than what we mere mortals you know, can see. So
mere mortals anyway. Now, the whole essence of this is tied to this exhibition called Aurora, which is dawn, means dawn. And that was the thinking behind producing something that depicts dawn, at the same time captures the cultural context. I've been fascinated by the Fulani people for a long time. So I've done quite a lot of work on the Fulani milkmaids and so on. So for example, my second work is based on that theme also. These are abstract figures of those women who wake up early in the morning to go to the market to sell their wares. They sell their fura or whatever, you know. And I've used those colors also to depict dawn. I've been working on this kind of work either as a collage or just simply an acrylic painting. But you will notice the graphical approach, which is what I've experimented with for a long time, which has now become something peculiar to me. So I use that flat color just to create some variety and difference peculiar to myself, really. And I'll play a lot around also with relief and using different objects to depict whatever I want to do. So basically that's what it is, an acrylic painting on board. I'm glad you like it.
You mentioned the Fulani maids. Just looking up there, I think I can see something that reminds me of, like, you know, the little calabash pots that the ladies used to carry on their heads. But one thing I wanted to ask you, just looking at the painting itself, do you have to have very delicate fingers to sort of like get the lines and stuff like that in place? Or do you actually, I'm sure I probably sound a little bit silly because I'm not an artist myself, because I'm looking and I'm thinking, how did you get these lines in place? Do you have to have sort of like real delicate fingers when sort of like using the brush?
Yeah, I combine using a free hand. At the same time, I mask some areas. Without masking, it's so difficult to get a sharp edge. And therefore, I do masking and I do freehand also. But a lot of those parts were masked so that you achieve that sharp edge.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay, so I've got Michael Echekoba with me, who's one of the artists displaying this evening at the WAC Art Gallery in Waterloo, with a beautiful piece of work titled Where Goeth Thou? So I'm going to leave him to actually take you and I on a journey as to what inspired him to actually create this lovely piece of work.
As the title goes, Where Goeth Thou? Is an interpretation of the theme for this year's exhibition, Alora, which means dawn or beginning. I've borrowed an idea from my feelings and my where I'm as a human being and the journey that I've gone so far, and I begin to look at life and things that affect me as a human being and other elements, i.e. the concepts behind this work has to do with displacement of people who, out of no fault of theirs, through democratization in parentheses, by the Western world of places like Iraq, Afghanistan, Syria, which is the present case in hand, Libya, places who have been managed by a supposedly dictatorship government, but in the past, they have managed to keep them under control. But the West think that is appropriate to democratize these places, and hence they've destabilized them. So my question is, have they left these places better than they were before the intervention of Tony Blair and George Bush, before David Cameron and Sarkozy went to Libya? The answer is no, because you have mass displacement of people all over the world. And apart from some of these displacements, we equally have internally displaced people. A case in hand is post-Nigerian Biafra Civil War. We have the Luandas. We know the genocide that took place in Luanda. We know about the problem that happened in Sudan. So I've tried to depict this displacement by first showing a back view of a crowd walking towards oblivion, towards the horizon. If you can see the perspective at which they are going, they seem to fading into an unknown. So from the pictures, you can see what they all have seem to be very little of their prized possessions. They have loads which are more or less emotional things that they have emotional attachment to, but where they're going to, they don't know. So hence the title, Where Goeth Thou?
So, last interview for the day with the president of the Nigerian Art Society himself, Hassan Aliyu. I've had a wonderful time this evening, just sort of like looking at the wonderful works of the different artists displayed here. I've had a look at your work as well. I had the privilege of actually hearing you sort of like interpret the work to a few people earlier on. But for the viewers of this video recording, I would like you to actually repeat yourself one more time.
Okay. Yes, hello. My name is Hassan Aliyu, and I am the president of the Nigeria Art Society. We founded this group in 1992, and at the time we had our challenges for a group of us of our kind and doing what we were doing. But over the years, it's proven easier and easier. Now we are an identifiable group. Our brand is well known, and our brand is a whole range of dynamic and diverse art in various media, and very exciting, very colorful. Hence the title of this exhibition, Aurora. And Aurora, in our interpretation effectively, is the spectrum of colors that you get, particularly with where we come from. We dress very flamboyantly, very colorfully. And we tend to see things other than in grays and in blacks. And that shows not only in our costuming, but also in our art. For me, color and form are such an important thing. However, having trained, in a Western educational context, the standard is that art or color painting is art is what you make with paint, what you make with standard materials. I've decided to deviate away slightly from that, and thanks to my great art teacher, Mr. Nelson Olawaye, to whom I dedicate this piece of work. He taught me how to be free to express myself as an artist. He taught me this when I was in secondary school. And ever since, I've had a very restless nature and pushed my my medium, my material, to stretch it to its parameters, to breaking point, where I did the unconventional. And here, I've created this piece which has got historical and social context to me as a person and to me as an African. The piece is derived from a painting which I did in 1992 called The Flight of the Maroon. This piece here is called A Passage on the Good Ship. The Good Ship, which I refer to in this work, is the Good Ship Jesus of Lübeck. And this ship was the slave ship that was captained by John Hawkins in the 1500s, the very first slave ship to make it across from Americas to from Africa to the Americas with live cargo of Africans. The Africans who were the passengers of this luxury yacht, as it were taken there and forced in labor, and subsequently developed the Western economies, Western infrastructures, developed the West. And did such a good job that also there was a loss to the societies that they came from, because these were talented musicians and talented, maybe even, heads of religious or the spiritual sector, artisans of the day, and warriors of their clans. And so therefore, while Africa was getting depleted of this valuable skills, Europe was getting enriched by them. But I thought I will reproduce or recreate this concept of the Flight of the Maroon and call it A Passage on the Good Ship in the wake of Brexit. And why this became important to me was because I perceive that the intolerance that has brought about the focus on immigrants as being a bad thing is occasioned by economic downturns of the country, largely, primarily. And basically, the man who once upon a time was brought on a good ship, and the justification for, one of the justifications for bringing him over to these lands to come and be exploited, was on the basis of religion. And so therefore, maybe it's no accident that the ship was called the Jesus, for its biblical connotation that Jesus will bring salvation to people. So anyway, the man who has come on a good ship suddenly finds himself being expelled on an even better ship called HMS Brexit. And so the events of Brexit has made me sort of take a review or look at the whole episodes of the migration into the West from Africa of Africans. In the present day, that migration is driven largely by economic issues and so displacements in their countries. Events, again, which largely are not directly attributable to them. They may be attributable to religion and or wars, or maybe their inclinations politically to one bloc or another. But generally speaking, I'm looking at the experience of the black man in the United Kingdom, and I find generally their net contribution to the development of the country, as well as to the culture, to enriching the culture, has been tremendous. Whereas the recent developments of the focus on the immigrants can be detrimental to that sort of social order that has been enjoyed for the last few decades. That's what the work is about. Thank you.
Okay, this evening I've heard a lot about, you know, politics and migration of people. I've heard the hearts of the artists, you know, expressed, you know, about what's going on around the world, be it Africa, Nigeria, and also right here in the UK where we live, and just sort of like everything brought together. So beautiful colors, you know, beautiful paintings on the wall, on the walls of this building, but there's a deeper issue. That's what I'm hearing, which you're actually putting across to the people who are actually who will be actually looking at this recording this evening. I just want to say it's just been a fantastic time here at the Art Gallery. I have been educated because art actually is not just about seeing beautiful paintings on a wall. It's actually about educating people. Sometimes, you know, the person, the layman, just sort of like looking at a piece of work on the wall doesn't quite grasp the story behind until you start speaking to the artist. I just want to say thank you very much for taking me on a journey. I have had a wonderful time. It's my first time coming here, but you can be sure I'll be here the next time you guys put together another lovely exhibition like this. Thank you very much.
A pleasure. Thank you so much. Thank you so much indeed.
So from the Art Gallery, Waterloo, London, all I can say is I have had a wonderful time this evening. Just looking at the paintings and looking at the beautiful works of my fellow Nigerians, I feel really proud to call myself a Nigerian. Beautiful things do come out of Africa. Beautiful things come out of Nigeria. So here's me encouraging you as I encourage myself. If you are an artist out there, this is one society you want to be a part of. There are beautiful things and beautiful Nigerians doing wonderful things in the UK. So do get in touch with them. If you are an artist out there, if you've got talent out there, let me encourage you. This is one place you want to be a part of. Thank you very much and good night.